On this week's episode, we compare two popular HD monitors for DSLR work, and I show you the behind the scenes on the set that I built for Video Business 101. DVTV starts right now.
This episode is made possible in part by Lightcraft Workshop, the perfect tools to create the perfect image. CPM Camera Rigs, your lightweight solution for caging the beast. Small HD, the world's smallest high-definition monitors. Cinemover, the versatile motion system for small cameras.
Hey guys, welcome to another brand new episode of DVTV, bringing you the next wave of digital video. I'm your host, Tony Reale. And today we're going to be talking about monitors, specifically high-definition monitors for both DSLR and other camera work. Now, your monitor can be probably your best friend on a shoot. It's a very important tool to have along with you. You can get by without a good one, but when you have a good one along with you, it's just going to make your productions a ton better. You're going to be more accurate, you're going to know what you're getting a lot better, and chances are you're going to have less retakes, less takes overall. So, to get started, there are two monitors out there that I consider my favorite. Now, you'll notice that they're both my sponsors. The reason for this is because I like their equipment, and I've invited them both to be sponsors. Which one is better, you might ask? Well, the answer is which one is better for you, not necessarily which one is better, period. They both are great monitors, and they both offer great features, and they both come in at different price points. So just as much as there's a different option for everybody who wants a car, you can get either a mid-range car or a luxury car, there's going to be options for you with these tools as well. So we're going to be comparing the features of each of them and describing which one is going to work best for you. So let's go ahead and get started with that. All right, so the two monitors that we're going to be looking at are the Small HD DP6 and the Manhattan LCD HD5. These are actually pretty much spec'd very similarly. They both have 1280 by 800 resolution screens. That would be a 1610 screen. So at 16:9, you can see there's a little bit of letterboxing happening. That's because we're feeding it a 16:9 image, and that would effectively then be 720p. So you're able to get HD resolution on these monitors and able to focus well with HD. Now, the nice thing about both of these monitors is they also feature DSLR scaling. And this allows you to, when you have a camera like the T2i or the 60D or the 5D Mark II, when you hit record, it'll drop down to SD. And so what's nice about these is they both have the scaling option so that when the image drops down, it stays full screen. For example, here I've got my 60D, I'm gonna hit record. You see they drop out. And then they come back up, and there you go. They're still full screen. Now, if this was a monitor that didn't have DSLR scaling, the images would have been much smaller in both of them. So that's a big plus. That's a feature that you really want to have in both of these monitors. I'm going to stop the recording. And there we go. Come back up. And so there you go. Now let's go ahead and compare some of the features first of all. Now the build quality is the first thing you're going to look at. You can see that the HD5 is a little larger, and this is because the buttons are pretty much on the face of it. The small HD though, the buttons are on the top, and it uses a different button system. It uses this toggle dial right here, and then these two buttons to select on and off. The power button is over here on the side. And that's pretty much it for buttons. Versus the Manhattan LCD, like I said, all the buttons are on the face right here. The design of the Manhattan LCD is kind of similar to like a Marshall monitor. It's basically got these molded metal platforms that are molded metal that kind of goes around the whole body and creates this nice square container. Versus the Small HD is a custom mold that's specific for this monitor. So the molding of this is all along here. It's specifically molded for this monitor, which gives it a little much more of a sleek design because it's able to hug every contour of the actual monitor. Both of them feel very durable, although maybe the Small HD a little bit more, but overall they've got a good build to them. For mounting, you've got your threads pretty much all around on here for the Manhattan LCD. You've got your thread here, thread on the top, right here, and that's pretty much it. So no more threads on the side, just top and back, or bottom and back there. So let's talk about inputs. The inputs options on the small HD are, you've got your component here, and one of these is also composite. I don't know if it's the red or green, but one of these is composite, and so you can send a composite signal into it. Then there's HDMI, which we're using right here. And this model, this is a more expensive model, this has the HDSDI on the top. You can also get the non-HDSDI model, which just has an HDMI and component composite. For the Manhattan LCD, we've got two HDMIs on the top. Unfortunately, this doesn't have HDMI loop through. It'd be really nice if it did, but it doesn't. It's just got two HDMI inputs there. And then again, you've got your component, composite, and VGA. So this is something the small HD does not have. It has VGA right there. Moving on, let's talk about the power options. For the Manhattan LCD, we've got the AC adapter that goes into it, and both of these monitors come with AC adapters. And then we have the battery play back here. This is using a Canon camcorder battery that you would see in like an XHA1 or whatever. So that gives you different options for extended life and stuff like that. But there are other mounting options you can get. There's Sony and Panasonic battery options as well. The small HD has a unique battery plate option, which is the LPE6 battery that are used for the Canon 7D, the 5D, and stuff like that. So you can use those batteries right in here. It takes two of them in order to operate, but that can crank out and power the device. I like that because I have a lot of the LPE6 batteries. But if you don't have those or you have a different camera, you can use different battery plate options. So both of those are interchangeable, and those are both options you can get. Again, the AC adapter right there as well. Moving on, let's talk about software. Now, for the small HD, in order to pull up the menu, we're going to click on the wheel, and that pulls up the menu options. You've got all your main menu options that you would be looking for. Contrast, brightness, all the image controls there. Advanced features like focus assist, peaking, false color, one-to-one scaling, blue only for calibration, all that kind of stuff. Input, you can select your inputs. Guides, aspect ratios, stuff like that. System selects. Miscellaneous, that can change the opacity of the menu, your language, version, stuff like that. Picture-in-picture control, that's nice, that has options for picture-in-picture. And that's pretty much it. So to exit that, we'll hit the back button. Moving on to the Manhattan LCD, we pull up the menu, hit the menu button right here. And then first off, we're presented with the picture controls, just like in the small HD. You've got your brightness, contrast, color, tint. There is also a option for preset, so you can set all these settings and then save it in a preset. But you can go down to sharpness, gamma, all that kind of stuff. So let's go up. For image adjustment, you've got your image size. This is where you change from your DSLR record to DSLR playback, and then other different options in there as well. So there's lots of different preset image sizes, or you can go in and select your own. So you can do a custom scale right in here. And both monitors offer that feature. And setup, you've got, again, the transparency, language, all that kind of stuff. Advanced, this is where you're getting your blue gun, false color, focus assist, all that kind of lovely stuff. And guides, again, aspect ratio, screen markers, stuff like that. So overall, you've got very similar features across both models. Now, in order to change your different scale sizes that we talked about, you have to go into the menu on the HD5, go down to image size, and change that back and forth. So not that involving of a process, but small HD makes it a little faster by being able to just use the jog wheel right here, rotate right, and that brings up your preset menu. Now, if I go up and click, now I can change that to DSLR playback. I scroll down and click, that brings it back to DSLR record. And if I exit out of there, now you quickly change that. So slightly faster on the small HD, though again, it's not too buried on the Manhattan LCD either. Both of these monitors are software upgradable. The small HD, you can actually do it yourself. It has a USB port right there, which allows you to quickly pop in the new firmware and upgrade that yourself. At least last I checked, the Manhattan LCD, you had to send it in. They may have an option now where you can user upgrade it yourself, but both of them are software upgradable, so that is nice. And the last thing I do want to address is accessories. There are accessories that you can get for these monitors. Some come with them, some are separate. Like, for example, the battery plates, those are separate items that you have to purchase. They add a little extra cost in there, and you can choose whichever one you want that works best for you. One nice accessory that you can get for the small HD are these acrylic screen protectors. These actually snap right into the face, and I have one on there right now. Without it, it would actually be a little thinner. And that's a really nice addition because you get a gouge on there. You can just pop it off, pop the new one on, and they're not that expensive. Unfortunately, Manhattan LCD doesn't have an option like that. They just have the peel-on screen protectors, which, again, are nice to have, but the snap-on ones are just a little nicer. Now, for sun hoods, there are two options, again, for you. Manhattan LCD has this ABS plastic sun hood that just pops together and threads on. They've got these little tighteners right here that you thread on, and that pops in. Though when collapsed, it's not quite as compact as the small HD model, which we have right here. And this is using kind of a nylon stretchy fabric stuff, and that clips onto the small HD monitor with these little grooves that are in there. Pops on, you've got your sun hood, and then when you're not using it, it's a little bit more compact, so fits in your bag a little bit better. So as you can see, at the end of the day, both of these monitors are offering a lot of the same features. Overall, they have the same resolution, they have the same DSLR scaling features, they have false color, they have peaking, they have a lot of those same features. But what you're going to see the difference in is some of the extra accessory options and build quality features that the small HD does have, and a little bit quicker menu design. But you're also going to see that there's a higher price tag with this. The current pricing for it is the small HD without the HDSDI option is $900, with HDSDI is $1,300, and the Manhattan LCD HD5 with no battery plate on either of these, you'd be looking at $650. So getting battery plate for both of these would add additional charge to it, but again, you're going to see that the Manhattan LCD is a little bit more cost effective, easier in the pocketbook, and the small HD does offer a little bit other additional features. Overall though, this is a great price point for either of these monitors, and they're really great to have. Especially having an HD monitor in your kit is going to be a great accessory for professional shooters.
This episode is made possible in part by JAG 35, affordable solutions for filmmakers. Manhattan LCD, the affordable solution for high definition monitoring. Rig Wheels, camera wheels for creativity. CheesyCam.com, the latest gear reviews and DIY video and photo projects.
All right, well, welcome back. Now, you guys may be wondering, where are we? This isn't the traditional DVTV set. And you are correct. We're actually on a set that I built for our new series, Video Business 101, How to Make Money in Video Productions. I highly encourage you to check that out. It's a great way to support our site and a really great way to learn how to get started in video business. We go over a ton of stuff in there, everything from just getting started to the different types of video production that you can get involved with, how to market yourself and sell yourself. And my favorite part is how to help your clients market themselves and do effective video advertising. This in and of itself makes it worth the price. So definitely check it out. But what I'd like to do today is share with you how I built this set. This set isn't anything fancy. It's a really, really basic set. But I built it here in my basement, same place that I shoot the rest of DVTV. And I want to show you just a real basic how you could accomplish this. Now, I'm not recommending going to the hardware store and building exactly what you see here. What I'm recommending is just take the basic concepts that you see, how to do the basic stuff and how to kind of cut corners to, as I describe soon, to make something really inexpensive and really basic look a bit more professional. So let's go ahead and I'm going to give you a walk around of the entire set and show you how I lit it and how everything works. All right, so this is about the angle that you just saw. Let's go ahead and show you the behind the scenes. First off, I'll show you my camera setup. I've got, I was actually using a 5D for the shoot, but I've got my 60D hooked up right now because my wife was using my 5D. But I've got the 5D or the 60D running with the new Beechtech DXA5DA, I think that's the name of it. I'm gonna do a review on this shortly, but basically it's XLR, balanced XLR converter. Worked really well. I didn't have to sync audio for any of the takes, so like I said, I'll do a full review of that later. But on my Manfrotto 504 HD, and that's running over to my small HD DP6. So that was how I could monitor myself. I also used my laptop for some of this too. That worked pretty well for start and stop recording, but this also works pretty good. So that's the camera setup. For my key light, I have my cool lights, little pop-up light that uses a Mogul based bulb in there. You can see that. Equivalent to about 700 watts of light, and I was using a tungsten color temperatured light there. So that was my key light. Now for my edge and rim lights and hair lights, this is actually just a 4-bank fluorescent from Cowboy Studio that I was using. I actually had two of the bulbs turned on. And up here we have one of the 312 LED lights. This one's from ICANN. And this one's color changeable, so I had it dialed into to daylight temperature. So both of these are daylight. That gave a nice little blue rim light. And the key light was tungsten. Now as for the set, the way that I built this is I bought this paneling here from Menards, and I got these. This is actually underlayment. I was originally going to do paneling for these pillars, but underlayment was cheaper, and it had a continuous wood grain instead of having like the you know, separated panel look that paneling would have. So I got those. Now the reason I did these pillars was a couple reasons. First of all, I didn't want to build a actual frame for these brick wall panels back here. So what I did was I just basically rested them against my ceiling tile with, as you can see up here, I've got these A-clips. And yeah, as they pretty much did the trick. I've got a couple of them just clamped on top, and they just rested on the back there. So normally my projection screen is behind here, but that gave me the ability to just rest them without having to build a frame. And then these pillars kind of covered up that gap. And then what I did was I basically built like a 2x4 framework just for them to stand up on. And these are actually just really cheap $10 fluorescent banks from Home Depot, and those each have two bulbs with tungsten color temperature, so they both are in there, and that gave a nice light on the background without me having to actually have any separate lights back there for it at all. So these just rest on there. Literally the only thing that's screwed together is the frames, so those frames. Otherwise everything's just kind of resting back here. And down here, these are the lights for the pillars, and this is these are both Britec lights. This one's they're both 200 watts each, and they were a little bright, so I put some scrims on top of them. These are scrims from my RE650, and just held on with a little close pin there. So that's the real basic lighting setup. Now, I don't have the lights on right now because they would blow out the camera. But let me go ahead and turn the lights on, give you an idea of what everything looks like. You can see the fluorescents starting up there. And there's a little bit of a flicker as they warm up. Yeah, that's the issue with getting cheap fluorescents, is they're not necessarily the most reliable things, but they, that was actually flickering more than usual. But once that gets warmed up, it should be pretty good. They can cause a little bit of a flicker, but if you use the correct shutter speed, you should be fine. There's the daylight one, and the daylight 300 up there, or 312 LED, and then the key light, which is then showing right here. So not a bad image. I like the look of this. Now, again, you could change things around. My room here is about 15 feet wide by about 30 feet long. So instead of going using the 30 feet for the length, I decided to use the 15 feet for the length of the room. And that gave me enough distance to separate myself from the background. to throw it out of focus, but also so that my key light here would not throw too much light on the background. That way I could light the background separate from myself and give it a nice look. So overall, I was very satisfied with the look that I accomplished here. And total cost for this entire set, just for hardware, lumber, everything like that, was about $150. So I can't complain at that at all. I already had these lights, so those don't factor in. But yeah, I was very, very satisfied with this look. And again, I'll probably change things around in the future, use these components separately. If you guys recognize, here's the chair that was used. My wife picked this up at a thrift store for about $5. So that was used for right here during the taping of Video Business 101. But there you go. Now, again, I could stain this. I was thinking about possibly using laminate flooring here with different colors, maybe for the future. The thing I like about having these pillars is it kind of hides that gap that created there. Otherwise, I'd literally have to build a 2x4 frame for this entire brick paneling section to get rid of that gap, which would have cost money and taken up a ton of space. Versus with these pillars, you know, at the proper camera angle, they hide it very well. So there you go. As you can see, everything comes together, all the lighting, all the set pieces to create this really nice set. Now, again, not everybody might like this. I think it works out really well for my location, for my budget, and for the overall feel that I was trying to accomplish for this series. Now, you may not see this set again for DVTV, but because of the modularity of it, I will probably use some of these pieces later on, either for DVTV or for other things. So again, building things with that modularity can help you out in the long run of being able to use them for other projects later on.
Want more Next Wave DV in your life? Make sure you subscribe to us on YouTube to be notified when the next episode airs. Visit our website for daily posts on the latest digital video news. Like us on Facebook to join the Next Wave DV community. And follow us on Twitter for behind-the-scenes news and pictures.